Good evening, everyone.
Okay.
I'm your evening host, Jaideep at Edo. Before we dive in, let me give you a quick glimpse into Edo. Edo is a global network of students and young professionals like yourself, all passionate about inspiring youth to make a positive impact. We connect you with stabilized professionals and offers a platform to learn from their journeys. Now, on behalf of Team Epic and Edo, we are thrilled to welcome you to this webinar on negative effects of poor education and training in societies and communities. To make this session even more engaging, we kindly request everyone to switch on their cameras. And now, the moment we all have been waiting for, our esteemed guest speaker for tonight is Ms.Sisanda. Ms.Sisanda has graduated from BCom Gender Accounting. Ms.Sisanda, is a true honor to have you with us today. We are all eager to gain valuable insights from your expertise. Ms.Sisanda, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Greetings to everyone in the meeting today. My name is Sisanda, as I have been introduced. I'm majoring in BCom General Accounting in Nelson Mandela University in South Africa. And the topic that I chose to talk about today is negative effects of poor education training in communities and societies. The reason why I chose this this topic is because I have seen that a lot of communities have a problem in terms of education, and their education system tends to be a bit poor than how the average education systems should be. So this negatively affects a lot of people and a lot of workers, a lot of countries, communities, and societies as a whole. So allow me to begin my presentation. So once again, I welcome you, ladies and gentlemen. I didn't know there wouldn't be any ladies, but then this presentation is going to mainly focus on what I've said before. And yeah, we can skip this one. Sorry. Okay, so education and training play a crucial role in the development of individuals and societies, as we know that everything begins from being educated. In order to know something and in order to know how something is done, you have to be educated about it. So education is more like a pillar of knowledge. So for a person to know something, to have knowledge about it, they have to be educated about it. And poor education can have detrimental effects on the community and society, as we're going to look into that further, that poor education can, however, affect a community or a society at large, even for five generations. Education is known as one of the pillars of knowledge for individuals. So it's more like education is basically a very crucial element into knowing something or being able to do something. My next point is, not only does it teach skills, but it also builds character for employment and many other aspects of life. As I've said before, it's basically everything starts with education. And if one doesn't have education, it's really hard to earn skills in order to be employed in future. So you'll find that a person cannot get employed because they do not have these certain skills that their employers do want. But we're going to dwell into that further in the next slides. So these are the effects that it can have. So these are the effects that poor education and training can actually have. These are directly things that it can actually have, which is a limited career opportunities and lower earning potential will be the first one we'll discuss. The lack of knowledge and skills to compete in the modern workforce will be the second point we're going to discuss. And risk of unemployment and poverty may increase. is the third one, and a reduction in economic growth and development, it will be our fourth point, and a decrease to the quality of life and the well-being of a community and for individuals. We can explore these effects now. So firstly, we talk about the limited career opportunities and earning potential. So firstly, careers require certain knowledge and skill sets. As I've said, I'll make a very clear example that a doctor would require certain qualifications in order for them to become a doctor. An engineer would require certain kinds of qualifications to become an engineer, and so on and so forth. So if one doesn't have these kind of skill sets and this kind of knowledge, it will be kind of hard for them to actually get into a career, a stable career that they can actually go on with and live on with. My next point is employers want to employ innovative and educated workers. So it comes to a point where in a workplace, one has to use the knowledge that they've had from school. They'll have to use the knowledge that they've had from maybe their training centers or training programs, because employers actually want somebody who's innovative, somebody who will come up with new ideas on how to do certain work, on new ideas on how to invent certain machineries, certain equipment, or on how to use them. So in this aspect, education is very much needed, because if one does not have innovation, they cannot create, and therefore it keeps the production process stagnant. So that means the production will be very stagnant. People won't be able to produce any more than they are producing, which affects a whole lot of other things rather than just their employers. And then my third point is no education means lower income. So I did make an example on my first point about doctors, and I did also make an example about engineers. Engineers and doctors have education, they have the skills, and they have the knowledge of doing whatever they do as doctors and engineers. But then their income also is in a level of their knowledge and skills, meaning that income is simultaneously equal to a person's knowledge and skills, meaning that if a person doesn't have the good knowledge and the good skills to actually do the work, then they will not get the job, and also their income will be at a very low, because certain skill sets requires expertise, they require diplomas, they require degrees, they require certification. So it will be hard for them to actually earn a good amount of money in order to make a living if they do not have the sufficient education and skills and training. Moving on to our next one. So here we talk about the lack of training and skills to compete in the modern workforce. So as we know, our world is currently moving to the fourth industrial revolution, where people actually have to be more technologically advanced and technologically educated in order to move in with the times. We're getting new cars that run by water every day. We're getting new ways on how to produce electricity without using up our raw materials. We're getting ideas on how to do certain things, on how to use our mobile phones, on how to use our laptops. So with these kind of innovations, with these kinds of moving times in that fourth industrial revolution, in the near future, maybe fifth industrial revolution, one needs to have the good skills and the good knowledge in order to compete in the workforce, because employers will always employ a person with proper skills. They will always employ a person who has more skills, and a person who has more knowledge, and a person who has more expertise. So limited knowledge to apply for work will be basically what can I say? So if a person has limited knowledge to apply at work, employers won't consider them, because employers want somebody with expertise. They want somebody who has knowledge of what they're doing. For instance, if we're talking about a lawyer, an employer will want a lawyer that actually knows each section of each book, that actually knows the constitution at its whole, and that actually knows the laws of the country and laws internationally if possible. So it, these things need skills and expertise to compete in the workforce, because employers will always go for somebody who has more education than the other person. And then my third point is employers will employ workers with more knowledge than the one that does not. As I said before, if I have a degree in law and another person does not have a degree in law and my employer needs a lawyer, they will employ me rather than employ the person without a law degree, meaning that education comes first and then every other skill set comes second, regardless of whether one is able to work critically or critically think, if I can say, if they're critical thinkers, but applying your critical thinking in your education could make it more of, could make you more of an expert in whatever you're doing. So these are the risks that may increase if one doesn't have education. So poverty and employment are one of the main factors that we focus on when we talk about education. Because in order for one to get an education, in order for one to be employed, they have to be educated. And in order for one to survive and be able to afford their basic needs, they have to be educated. So communities rely on jobs for income. In order for someone to earn any kind of income, they actually have to work for that income. They have to have a job for that income. Whether it's a job that pays you weekly, or whether it's a job that pays you monthly, or any kind of job, but you, in order for you to survive or to make a living or to actually afford your basic needs, you have to have an income. So communities solely rely on income in order to survive. So for one to earn an income, they need to work. As I've said, it's either you work in a factory, it's either you work, you're a teacher, it's either you're an engineer, it's either you're a lawyer, an accountant, whoever you are, but in order to earn something, you have to actually work. And then one receives skills and knowledge by being educated. So this means basically that education is, as I've said before, that education is basically the pillar of knowledge. So in order for one to actually receive employment, they have to have the skills and knowledge. And in order to actually earn an income, you have to be employed and you have to have those skills and knowledge. So it goes hand in hand. It's a simultaneous thing, that each thing that you do in life goes back to being educated. So if you're gonna work, if you need an income, you have to be educated. If you need employment, you have to be educated still. And then the risks of being unemployed. So if a person doesn't have education, they risk being unemployed. They risk many doors being shut because of they don't have the skills or the knowledge, or they risk of getting a very low paying job where they can't even afford their basic needs. So now they'll have to basically maybe start a business on the side or do whatever in order to meet their basic needs. But most of the time, it's difficult for one to work at the same time and to also have an entrepreneurial something going on the side. So if you don't have education, training, and skills, you risk being unemployed. You risk not having a job, because no employer wants someone who is not very capable of doing certain jobs. So poverty may increase as one has no income. So if one has no income, their basic needs that they cannot pay for instance, they cannot pay for shelter, they cannot pay for food, they cannot pay for clothing, and they cannot pay for maybe education for their kids if they do have kids, or they cannot pay for certain things like expenses, like minimum expenses. So this creates poverty. And in one thing, if a generation is in poverty, the next generation is highly possible for the next generation to be in poverty. Because if we look at many statistics, if we find that a mother was maybe, let's just say, a person who cleaned, and then the father was a farm worker, it's highly possible that the children will also follow that line. Because if the mother and the father did not have education, then it's highly possible that the children won't afford education because they have minimal wages that can't actually pay for the education that the children need. So poverty may increase from generation to generation, and this may cause a lot of problems for the community or the country as a whole. So a reduction in the economic growth. So economic growth basically is more than one thing. Basically, economic growth depends solely on production, because when we calculate the economic growth of a country, we include the GDP, right, which is the gross domestic product, which is a production of a country, or how much a country can actually produce. So the production of a country greatly depends on its labor. So if a country has people who actually good in labor, and if a country has people who actually can work and who actually can do the job, then its production levels will be very high, meaning that that country will, excuse me, that country will operate more money, that country will get more money, that country would actually have a good currency. So the economic growth depends on production, but then the production depends on its labors, on its workers. So the more people have skills, the more the production increases. So it's like, if people have skills to do certain job, if people have expertise to do certain job, if people have skills to be foremen, if people have skills to work in factories, if people have skills to be engineers, to be manufacturers, to be, you know, all those kinds of job, then the production process will increase, because then people know actually what to do. People can create new machinery that will make work faster. People can create new equipment that allows efficient working. People can create many other innovative products that can actually allow people to work much faster, meaning that the production increases. And therefore, if production increases, that means the economic growth also increases, which means it blooms. New innovations such as machinery and equipment up to speed and the production process. As I've said before, so employees come up with innovative ideas on to build machinery, to build equipment, to build, basically, I can say, things that will make work much faster and much easier, that will speed up the process of production, because we know that production is a very long process. So it goes from one production cycle to the other, to the other. But if people, employees are educated enough to actually innovate things, are actually smart enough to actually innovate machinery, to innovate equipment, they can speed up that process, and then it increases the economic growth, because now the economy is producing more, it's selling out more, there's more exports in the country, and therefore it's receiving more income, and also the individuals and communities are also receiving more income. But if workers lack the capacity to be innovative or creative, this decreases production process and simultaneously reduces the economic growth. So if people lack the capacity to be innovative, meaning that they do not have enough knowledge, they do not have enough skills, they do not have enough training, and they cannot be creative about certain things, because one cannot just wake up and decide that they want to build a machinery that will do this type of work. People actually need to be skilled about it. They need to know which parts go where. So in order for a person to actually do that, they have to be educated. So if people are not educated, they lack the capacity to be innovative about this kind of things. They lack the capacity to be innovative about things in the production process that could actually increase the production process and that could actually increase the economic growth. And then this then results to basically the economic growth not growing at all, the economy not growing at all, people losing their jobs, retrenchments, basically just fluctuations of money, currencies, and everything else. And then the last point is economic growth is highly dependent on the education quality. To emphasize on the last point, economic growth does depend on any other labor, but then it also depends on the quality of education, because then the quality of education has to be very high. People have to be very great at their job. They have to be expertise. They have to have studied for years in order for them to know that job. So in order for them to excel in that job, contribute to the economy, they have to be expertise. They have to know this job. Because then if any kind of employer employs a person who is not well, I could say well educated or is not an expert in what they do, then it's really hard for them to do their job well, and it's really hard for the production process to go any faster, and the economy won't flourish as much as it should, because there are no experts in the country. There are no people who can actually or who know, or there are very few people who actually know how to do these jobs.
And yeah, if you have network issue, you can just turn off.
As I was saying, it decreases value of life and well-being. I was still explaining the poverty leads to lower life expectancy. So life expectancy basically means an age in which people actually pass away at. A country may have a life expectancy of 75, may have a life expectancy of 55, and may have a life expectancy of 80, depending on the actual life expectancy of that country. That means the majority of people who pass away at an old age, like which age do they normally pass away at? So people die due to nutrition or due to no income. So this is where life expectancy comes from. If a person then has a low life expectancy, it means that they're from a poverty background with no nutrition and no income. So now they cannot pay for their basic needs. They cannot pay for basic food, like they cannot pay for food. They cannot afford to live at all. So their life expectancy will be much shorter, because now they will die at a very young age because they cannot afford the basics. They cannot afford to survive. And then some people, due to health issues caused by disease. Minimum education means minimum experts in, let's say, experts in doctors, if I can say that. I can make an example of doctors. So if there are no experts such as doctors who can actually cure diseases, because there's minimum education in that community or minimum education in that society, then it means that people can have a short life expectancy, because if a disease comes, maybe a natural disease comes, and then people cannot actually cure it because now they don't have educated, they don't have experts that are educated in that field, and therefore they will have health issues. One of something that I always like to think when I'm thinking of a short life expectancy is diseases that are caused by shorter life expectancy because of diseases is when I think of malaria. A lot of African children from Africa die due to West African, sorry. From West Africa die at a young age due to malaria, and also older people also have a lower life expectancy due to them being sick of diseases that actually come. And because of the educational system that may be a bit flawed, they cannot afford to have doctors, they cannot afford to actually have experts that can actually cure malaria or come come with a cure for malaria. And then we talk about the low birth rate. So low birth rate, basically, I'm sorry that this was supposed to be same bullet point. Low birth rate due to shortage of medical care or medication in terms of complicated pregnancy or birth. So this means low birth rate means then children actually die before birth, or they actually die a few months after birth. This means that the people do not actually get enough healthcare or sufficient healthcare to actually make sure that the pregnancies last longer, or that when children are born, they're actually taken care of. So this is more like a medical care or a medication problem, in which by if a person does not have education, a community does not have enough education, then there are not enough doctors to actually be able to prevent this kind of things happening, like children dying before pregnancy or children dying a few months after pregnancy. So it decreases the value of life and well-being. And also one thing that I wanted to add was lifestyle. People cannot actually afford a lifestyle. They become so poor that sometimes they don't have shelter, they don't have food, they have to live on the street. They cannot afford a comfortable lifestyle for themselves and their children because of lack of education. So this is what this slide is all about. In conclusion, our communities greatly depend on education for survival. As I have made examples of having to have an income in order to survive, having to have an income in order to afford food, having to have an income in order to afford clothing and everything. So our communities depend on education for survival. They depend on education in order to know and in order to be experts in any kind of grow their economy. And education has to be taken as a priority in order to strengthen countries' economy and reduce poverty. So a system of education basically means that a country, if a system of education is strong, it means that the country does not have poverty. But if the educational system is weak, that means the country can have poverty, because then the country does not have actual people who have the knowledge and skills in order to grow their economy as they should. The third point is we need more training of skills in school to enhance all practical training that can be applied in the workplace. So sometimes education itself in a theoretical form is not the only type of education that our society needs, because in order to actually know how to do something, you have to do it by hand. So this is where training and skills come from. Training programs that actually help the communities to actually know how it is done. Training programs that enhance practical training such as maybe building, construction, practical training such as technological practical training, any training that actually enhances a person's education or skills to be applied in the workplace. Because then if a person can have practical skills, then they can be able to use it in the workplace. If a person has practical skills, they can use it in their workplace. So this really needs to be enhanced. Education is a success of every nation. I'm sorry for that. And therefore, we need to invest in it. Every nation across the globe needs to invest in education in that particular country, because then education means the country is going to be well off. The lifestyle of the people in that country is going to be well off. A GDP per capita, which means GDP per person in that country, is going to be high, and people will actually afford their basic needs and also afford to save, meaning economic growth will be at its largest. And this is end of my presentation, and you may ask any question regarding the presentation. Thank you
Ms. Sisanda. I request the participants to submit their doubts and questions in the chat box, and Ms. Sisanda will answer them accordingly. There is a question in chat box.
Okay. What way? Oh, okay. You're going to read it. It's fine.
Okay. In what way does a lack of education affects employment opportunities and job security?
Okay. Firstly, employment opportunities, right? means that a person gets an opportunity to actually be employed. So if a person does not have education, for instance, an employer can say, I need somebody who has administration. If a person does not have that kind of education in administration, then there are low possibilities that they will get employed. There are low possibilities that they will have employment opportunity. If an employer said they want somebody who has mathematics, and a person is not educated, then the chances of them actually getting that job are very low. So, the second one is job security. Job security to me basically means that a person actually keeping their job, a person having a job and keeping their job, meaning they have job security. When it comes to job security, it's more or less of, in terms of promotion, will you be promoted or can you keep your job? If your a company is evolving, as I've said before, we from fourth industrial revolution maybe to fifth, and if a person doesn't have enough qualifications for the fifth industrial revolution, can they actually keep their job? Because now the employer actually wants somebody innovative and creative enough to move with them to the fifth industrial revolution. So this means that if a person does not actually have those certain knowledge and skills, and they don't have the education to actually be innovative and creative towards them. So the lack of education really affects employment opportunities, because employers want somebody with the skill sets and the knowledge. And job security means that you cannot keep your job forever if you don't have the enough education to move with the times.
Okay. And there's one more question. Is competition in education good or bad?
I think it's good. I think, in my opinion, it's good. Reason being, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Reason being, we live in a world where we have currencies, as we know. We live in a world where we have to compete with the currencies. We have to make sure that our currency does not hyper inflate. We have to make sure that we do not have hyperinflation or anything of that sort. So competition in education allows people to actually know if their education is good enough to compete in the modern world. Because then you can have education in your country, or you can have education in your community, but is the education good enough to compete in the real world? Is the education good enough to compete internationally? So it's very good to have education competition, because then each country or each community gets to learn that, we have this kind of education, but if we take our learners or our students out there to the workplace to work maybe across the border or to work overseas, will they actually be able to apply the skill sets and the knowledge that we have given them in this education system? So to compete in education, it's a good thing. I could say it's a good thing.
I think these are only the questions. So we can move forward now. So as we are near the closing ceremony, before we depart, we would like to thank Ms. Sisanda, Dinesh, Simran ma'am, Pradipta sir, and my responsible teammate for making this session webinar a success. A.Dyan connects you with stabilized professionals and offers a platform to earn more from their journeys. So if anyone is interested, you can visit the website. We have shared our link in chat box. We request you to give your valuable feedback there. Once again, thank you everyone for joining. The webinar is now completed, and you may now leave the meeting. Thank you everyone.